Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming and spending your Friday evening with us. My name is Andrea Bursler. I am the Executive Director for Carroll County Public Library. And I thank you for coming and welcome you to this Battle of the Books author celebration. We have a few people we need to say thank you to who make these kind of events possible. First, we want to thank our sponsors, the Friends of Carroll County Public Library, and our Choose Civility Grant for providing the additional funding for this program tonight. We also want to thank our partners with the Carroll County Public Schools, and we want to say a special welcome to Irene Hildebrandt, who is the head of the school librarians, the school media specialist, who is with us this evening. We also want to thank the many sponsors for Battle of the Books who make it possible for us to buy all of those wonderful titles and make them available to your team so you can read them and enjoy them and learn them. Before we get, and also we want to say very special thank you to A Likely Story Bookstore, who is our partners in this event and who are providing all of those titles out there in the lobby for you, and the Carroll Community College for making their theater available to us. It's a wonderful space for our events. Our program tonight features talks from authors Cammie McGovern and Rue Zhu. They will be interviewed by Ted Zaleski, our good friend, an avid reader, and the Director of Management and Budget for Carroll County. Ted will then lead a question and answer period with the authors after the interview. We will have books for sale and signing in the lobby. If you brought books from home, you can get those signed as well. Cammie McGovern is the author of two books for young adults, Say What You Will and A Step Towards Falling, and two books for middle grade readers, Just My Luck and Chester and Gus, which is a Battle of the Books selection. All feature people with a variety of disabilities, and she has been widely honored for her advocacy work on behalf of people with disabilities. Fellow Battle of the Books author, Catherine Applegate calls her work joyful, inspiring, and unforgettable. She is one of the proud founders of Whole Children's Milestones, a resource center for children and young adults with disabilities and their families. She lives in Amherst, Massachusetts, with her husband, three sons, the oldest of whom is autistic. Rue Zhu grew up in Indianapolis and received a degree in sequential art from Savannah College of Art and Design. She is the creator of the popular webcom Saint for Rent. Newsprints, A Battle of the Books selection, is her first graphic novel. The sequel to Newsprints, Endgames, was just released. Her favorite things include historical fiction, fat birds, you have to explain that one, and coffee-flavored ice cream. Please join me in welcoming Cammie McGovern and Rue Zhu.
My name is Cammie McGovern. I have got four books for kids. These two are for older kids, so once you hit sixth grade and up, they're kind of, that's an okay age for. And these two are for middle grade. They all feature kids with disabilities at the center, as you already heard. And part of my motivation in doing that when I got started writing, I was actually used to be an adult kind of suspense fiction writer. And then I had three kids and my oldest son had autism. And one of the things that happens to parents when they have a kid with a significant disability like that is that at the beginning, right when your child is first diagnosed, and he was our first son, So we didn't really know what parenting would be like, and there's a real mourning period in which you feel like your life is going to be a tragedy ever moving forward. And one of the first things that your kid teaches you is that they are not at all a tragedy and that they are ready to get on with life. And as you heard, I got together with a group when Ethan was in preschool and started a group, an after-school resource center, and got to know a lot of kids with disabilities. And it was one of the main things that struck us all was how these kids are so just still ready to embrace life and ready to, and so unself-conscious in a way that we could actually all learn something from, I felt. And passionate about what they were passionate about. That's so frequently a thing with autism, that they love what they love and they carry their family and their parents with them to train stations and radio museums and all the places they love. So when I went to, when I started reading with, Ethan has two younger brothers and we were reading a lot of kids' fiction, and I felt like we didn't have enough kids' books that had somebody with disabilities at the center, but that wasn't their main problem. And because by that point I was figuring out that kids with disabilities have a lot more in common, even, and Ethan is really quite autistic. He's verbal, but quite autistic. He had much more in common with typically developing kids than most people would probably think. And he wanted friends, he liked the same things that other kids liked, he was a sports fan and a music fan, and so I wanted to start telling stories that were about those kids and getting on with life, that they all wanted the same things and had other issues and problems. So here's my three kids, and this is Ethan on the side, on the far left, and this is when they were young. And then here's just a little bit about autism. So one of the things I wanted to do with Chester and Gus is talk about, is present a character. So a lot of times we've seen autism as a spectrum disorder, which means basically that there's a wide variety of how it can manifest itself, that there can be people that are really, really, really super verbal. It means your brain works very differently, and it means that you process information differently, and that some things might be very easy for you, and some things might, like simple conversations, you might be able to really do math unbelievably well, and simple conversations are hard to process and know what to say back to the other person. And it also can be that at the other end of the spectrum, that just language and conversation is really difficult. And I felt like we were starting to see a lot of books about kids that were on the more verbal end of the spectrum. And I wanted to write a story that was about a kid that wasn't so verbal. And that was where I thought of the Gus story, and how Ethan didn't talk until he was about four, and or didn't really have language till he was four or five. And I was really obsessed with getting him to talk and getting language from him, and would keep lists of all the words he had and would make him, you know, use your words and say it in a sentence. And somewhere along the way, when during that whole period of being super obsessed with all that, we got a dog, a chocolate lab named Buddy. And somewhere in there, this is just the seed for the idea of Chester and Gus, somewhere in there, dogs teach us that words are not the only way to communicate. It helped me lean back a little bit and relax a little bit and realize how much could happen without language, and that Ethan would learn to interact and talk in his own way and in his own fashion, and he did. So one of the things that I'm hoping the book that Chester and Gus will do is teach kids a little bit about, who don't know much about autism, about what's behind or what's going on with the kids that might be in your classes or in your school who do have autism and behave in different ways, and to not be scared of it and not be scared of asking questions about it. What I can tell you about Ethan now is that he's 22 years old, and we just did an event last week at an elementary school in Connecticut, and we were trying to talk about things that other kids in elementary school did that were really helpful, that he really liked when he was young and having a hard time. And it was amazing how much he remembered. I couldn't get over it. It was the kids who gave him fist bumps and high fives, and they had little funny jokes, and it would have been interactions that took place like over 20 seconds in the hallway, but they did it over the whole time during elementary school. And I wanted to just include that sort of message, or I'm hoping that to include the message that The best teachers for kids who have social skills difficulty are actually their peers and other students. And some students are enormously good at reaching out and being kind and empathetic and may not even realize how much of an impact they have. You don't have to reach out and try and interact or engage with kids with disabilities and differences. But boy, if you're the type that's kind of interested in those kids and finding out more and maybe one day, working with them or just befriending them, it's incredible what an impact you can have by tiny little things that you can do. Ethan was remembering a kid who volunteered to work with him 2 years in a row on a science project, kids who helped him in band, and the kids who high-fived and had little jokes with him. And he remembered every single one of their names. He remembered their birthdays. It was pretty touching. And I think that's now your turn.
Oh, okay. Hello, everyone. Hi. My name is Ruzu. And first of all, thank you for coming out to see all of us tonight. As you might know, you might know me from my graphic novel series, Newsprints, or some of you might know me from my web presence online with my webcomic, Saint Ferent, or my mini project, Appeal. A major question that I get asked a lot is, what made you want to create comics? And the answer is comics. Comics was my biggest influencer, and I watched and read a lot of comics and comics-inspired animations growing up. I love it. It's a form of storytelling that's easy and intuitive for the audience to pick up, especially with Japanese comics, which are known as manga. Series I loved from childhood were Yu-Gi-Oh!, Sailor Moon, basically anything by Rumiko Takahashi, such as Inuyasha. I love the sense of drama that manga had, as well as the combination of whimsiness and as well as edginess, because, you know, I was a teenager at the time. So I also love strip comics, you know, the newspaper strips that you used to read in the funny section. And I used to cut them out and collect them as a kid until I realized that they already came in collections and books. So my favorite was Calvin and Hobbes, and I love that Calvin and Hobbes mixed philosophy with comedy by swinging between the mundane and the absurd. So one minute Calvin's playing with his dinosaurs, and the next minute the dinosaurs came to life, and they're talking about something really stupid, but it relates to the human experience. And so that's also something that's influenced the kind of stories I prefer and the kind of stories I like to tell. But not all inspirations for comics come from comics themselves. And that brings me to what happened after I grew up a little bit more. And I went to college. I went to the Savannah College of Art and Design in Georgia. And we're going to call it SCAD because it's a mouthful. I majored in sequential art, which is basically the art of visual storytelling, telling a story. And I also minored in animation and storyboarding, which means that basically for 4 years, I thoroughly studied the art of text and imagery and putting them together to tell a story. I wasn't only studying comics in college, but also film and TV and seeing what they did in order to tell, you know, a story. Because sometimes you can fit something into three panels and it's like setup, you know, story, and then punchline, right? But, you know, sometimes it's a lot funnier if you see it in motion. So that's where animation or film and TV come in. And historically, comics and film actually have a lot in common because they were created around the same time period, and they grew around the same time period, which is the early 20th century. And that is a very fascinating time period, but we'll get more onto that later. People also ask me, should I go to art school? Should I go to SCAD? And I'm gonna be honest with you guys, I was supposed to go to law school. But SCAD gave me a full academic scholarship, which means I didn't have to pay for tuition. And I know that's a major point in the college experience now is how high tuition prices are. So if you want to learn about comics right now and you want to sort of like, you know, take a crash course, I recommend Understanding Comics by Scott McCloud. It's a book that explains how comic works as a medium and why it works so well to tell a story. And if you want to go one step further and make more comics, you can also read the aptly named Making Comics by Scott McCloud, which goes further into that. So anyway, back to me in college, having a great time. In college, I I experimented with comics and the internet. I created a webcomic called Saint Ferent. Quick heads up, Saint Ferent is a YA story about a young man who runs an inn for time travelers, the hospitality side of time travel. Basically, he's a magnet for supernatural mayhem and as well as human drama as his time traveling friends and family come in and out of his life. When I created Saint Ferent, it was actually around the time that Homestuck, this infamous web entity, had gained its huge following. And it was also a time when cinemagraphs were a thing. Cinemagraphs are like photos, but only one part's animated. So maybe it's a picture of a cup of coffee in a cafe, and everything else in the cafe is still, but there's steam rising from the coffee, and it's like moving in real time. So that's what a cinemagraph is. With Homestuck, it was a story about kids and aliens and so many other things, but it also incorporated animated GIFs in the comic format, as well as text chats, games, and you know, Flash, just like everything you could throw at the internet to see how it would work. With me, I was kind of more of a humble project in that it was just an animated webcomic with GIFs, so certain panels would move. So I started updating it 2 to 3 times a week. In my heyday, it was about 4 times a week. Now I'm back to 2 updates a week, and it's still going. It's about 400 pages so far, a little more than that, and I update on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So as you can tell, working on this project made me realize that you can draw a comic, because that's one of the things that people ask me is, you know, how do you start? How do you know, you know, what's a good time to start drawing comics? Well, it's just, you just have to do it. One page at a time. And your art style and the things that you learn will affect how future pages look, but at the same time, that's cool. That just means you're growing. So my current web project is called Appeal. It's about a werewolf lawyer who falls in love with a single dad vampire, and they raise a magical girl daughter. And it channels more of my influences with manga and anime in terms of like this kind of artwork and the kind of concepts that I liked. It was also a way for me to explore my interests in fashion and also folklore and fantasy. Comics doesn't have to be your primary source of inspiration when you're making comics. If you want to tell a story, if you like things, just, you know, draw and write about them. And I'm going to use that to segue into my newsprint series. And Newsprints, as a heads up, is about a girl named Blue who, while disguised as a newsboy, uncovers a huge government secret. All the characters in Blue's Country of Gauzwing are based on Mother Goose nursery rhymes that I really liked when I was a kid. And they are at war with a country called Grimea, which has characters from Grimm's fairy tales, basically. Blue must navigate through both countries in order to save her friends from the ravages of war. As you can see, the Newsprint series allowed me to explore a lot of things I was interested in. Birds, for example. I love birds. You asked, what is it about fat birds? They're just fat. and I love that a lot. For Newsprints, I mentioned earlier that I liked the early 20th century, as well as a lot of the geopolitical tensions of the time. I like to read about that. So that also went into Newsprints, even though that the story takes place in a world that's not our own, but it's sort of a, you know, what if World War I had never ended and it just segued into World War II, and flight hadn't even been introduced as a concept yet until now. So it took a really long time for me to create the world of Newsprints because I was just researching a lot of things I liked and saying, I'll make a story out of that sometime. And in college, freshman year of college, I created the characters and also kind of the world that they lived in and for one project. But then I went back to it every other project as I went through school until I had thoroughly developed the characters and world to a point where I could put it all together into a storyline. And I put it all together into a pitch for a graphic novel series and in the also aptly named class, The Pitch. In my senior year, and that's what I sent to my future editor at Scholastic, who published Newsprints. Now, the funny thing about newsprints is that. It's one of those projects I had where I managed to save everything I put into it. I was actually able to make a little art book later on in my career. It comprises like all of the concepts that I put into making the characters, as well as all the fashion choices I decided on when it came to the characters. And also things like architecture, and because when you're designing like a world, you're also looking at things that make up the world, including like the buildings, the streets, the kinds of people that walk on those streets. And it's very interesting because my style continued to change because I was still learning as I was creating this story. And for any young creators in the audience, it's okay if your style keeps changing all the time, or if you think that, you know, nothing you draw looks the same as something you've drawn before. It just means you're still learning. And that's also, you know, that's cool, because if you stop learning, then you're not gonna be able to make cool things anymore. So that brings us to Endgames. This is the sequel to Newsprints. In Endgames, Blue goes to Germaia. And I won't say any more because it's only been, I guess, 2 months since the book has been released, so no spoilers. But it's also a way for me to look back on Newsprints and see the changes I decided to do, to make between Newsprints and Endgames in terms of like the colors I chose, as well as the kind of characters I designed. These two books comprise my early to mid-20s in everything I was interested in back then. And I like to think that it's kind of a snapshot into everything that I really liked at this age. So I hope you guys enjoy it. Thanks for coming out again.
First, I didn't know about you and liking Calvin and Hobbes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big comic strip reader too.
Oh,
Calvin
good,
and Hobbes is my favorite. I have the 3-volume complete collection of Calvin and Hobbes at home.
Nice. That's impressive.
That's how many of you know about Calvin and Hobbes? Okay,
oh,
this will work then.
Yeah.
My favorite Calvin and Hobbes comic strip. Calvin is pounding nails into a coffee table, and his mother comes in and says, "What are you doing?" And he gives her this funny look and says, "Is this a trick question?" All right. So, Rue, secrets are pretty much the story of Newsprints.
Indeed.
Can you talk a little bit about whatever you feel like you can say about the secrets, but also, did the secrets drive the book, or did the secrets kind of emerge as you were coming up with the story?
Well, I feel like growing up, all of us have a deeply profound life of secrets as a kid and also as a teenager, because there's just some things that we know are important, Mom, you wouldn't understand. So I think in a lot of cases, we kind of don't realize that the world is much bigger than, you know, from, you know, our own sort of lives, to the point where we have these secrets that we think are such a big deal, but if we just told some of them to people that we trust, we'd find that they were actually a lot more understanding and they want to help more than they want to hurt us. And with Blue's secret, Blue is a girl who learned that only boys can sell newspapers in her hometown of Nautiline. So she thought, well, in that case, that means I have to be a boy to sell newspapers, so I'll just disguise myself as one. And it never really occurred to her to just say, I'm a girl and I just want to sell newspapers. And I think one of the things that is important about keeping secrets is knowing that if you have, you know, people who love you and trust you, and you trust them, then, you know, you're in a safe space to tell them.
There's a line in the book that I think kind of is the heart of the book. Chester says, there's no better feeling than knowing there's one person in the world who depends entirely on you. You just talk about that idea a little bit?
So for those who haven't read it, Chester is a dog who's failed out of service dog school. And for anybody, so our dog, that was not the case with our chocolate lab buddy. But I knew, I had a friend who had a dog that had failed out of service dog school, and she was Ethan's brother's second grade teacher, and she used to bring him into class, and it was just an extraordinary dog. And it was he was so smart, and the kids loved him so much, and he was such a therapeutic dog for Ethan's brother, who had no troubles at all. Like, he just helped every kid in a different way in that room. And that's what got me started thinking about those connections, and then started researching dogs, service dogs, and dogs who fail out of service dog school. But one of the amazing things about service dogs is that they really and truly form that bond, that they train often not for particular disabilities, but for to make the connection. And so they're trained to connect with the person and see what they need and judiciously figure it out. So one group of, if you have watched that documentary Pick of the Litter that was on Netflix, I think it still is. If anybody's obsessed with this topic, it's a great documentary. And there's a group, it's a whole litter of puppies, and they're all intensively trained, but when they're going to get partnered with their person with disabilities, it's a wide different variety that of things that they will do, and they learn that on the spot with that kind of connection. And I suppose that if I think about it now, that's what happens with when you're parenting someone with autism, that you're just so unsure. You love this child so much, and you're so unsure what he needs. And I kind of wanted the dog to be just trying to figure out how to be a friend best way he could, the same way siblings would and parents would around. It's also true of all dogs, isn't it, that they just love and want to connect.
Yeah, for those of you who haven't read the book, Chester the dog, we can hear what Chester, or we can,
it's we told can from the point of view yeah. of Chester, yeah.
So we know what Chester's thinking.
Yeah.
You like historical fiction, Rue, it's come up, and fat birds. I don't know that there are any fat birds in this book, but there certainly are a lot of birds in this book. And you kind of touched on historical fiction. And I wanted to ask you, do you have any favorite writers of historical fiction?
I like mashups of fantasy and historical fiction, as you've noticed with newsprints. Right now I'm working through a series by Naomi Novik called Her Majesty's Dragon, which is about the Napoleon Wars, Napoleonic Wars, except there's dragons involved.
Neat.
On both sides?
Yes.
Okay. And coffee ice cream, which I'm pretty sure didn't show up in here. You kind of touched a little bit on how historical fiction drove some of what you did here. Mm-hmm. Can you talk some more about the birds? Like I said, there's a lot of birds in here, and I can't help but thinking that there was some things in your mind that aren't necessarily obvious when you look at this.
Well, I just like birds in general, so that's one thing. But some things kind of pop up here and there regarding birds, because, you know, they're fantastic metaphors for anything in the world. But one thing in particular that comes to mind is in Endgames, the sequel to Newsprints, Blue's friend Hector, who's 17, is accompanying Blue to the capital of Altalis. And when at the train station, they meet a group of war supporters who want Hector to join the war effort as a soldier. And Hector doesn't want to because he's a war journalist, and he says that you can't, you know, convince me that, you know, this effort is beautiful and glorious when I've actually been on the battlefield and I've seen all the terrible things that have happened. And the supporters, they throw white feathers at him and they call him a coward. And this is actually a direct tie back to World War One, yeah, World War One in Britain, where young women would give men white feathers because they weren't soldiers, and it was to shame them into joining the war effort. So you'll see like bits of that throughout the Newsprint series, just little cultural things.
Okay, Cammie, you've described yourself as the younger sister of an adored sometimes overly perfect sister.
Oh, did I say that? I'm sure I did at some
point. Well, not to me, but I did read it in another interview. Does this sound like something you might have said?
I'm sure.
And in the same thing, you talked about Beverly Cleary and Ramona and Beezus. I think you were relating that relationship to you and your sister, maybe. Are there any Beverly Cleary fans in the room?
The older, what's funny about, if you were a parent that loved Beverly Cleary, boy, those books still hold up, and they're so different to read them as an adult. Has anybody done that now? You remember loving them, and then you read them to your kids? They're wonderful. They're a great read aloud, too. So my older sister, it's funny that, is Elizabeth McGovern, who's in Downton Abbey, and so that's why I was thinking you were headed there. And part of Downton Abbey has people handing out, there's a scene where they're handing out white feathers. I'm trying to tie this all together. But you weren't segueing into talking about...
I wasn't. I didn't even realize that.
Oh, isn't that funny? So what was the second part of the... What was the question? I'm so sorry.
You made the comment about how you adored your sometimes too perfect sister.
Yeah.
And then it was the Beverly Cleary, Ramona Beezus thing.
Oh, and I was like Ramona and she was Beezus. I got it. Yes, definitely. And she was so perfect back then. Yes. Now, less so. Now she's, we just are doing separate things different artistic forms. I would actually say, I think her courage in becoming an actress prompted me to want to say it was the last thing our parents wanted her to do. The last thing. They're both English teachers. My father was a law professor. My mother was an English teacher, but they were both very academic. And the last thing they wanted my sister to do was become an actress. And when I watched her go through that process, I thought, maybe I'll do this little kind of bold thing I would like to do as well. I was a very, very shy kid. I was not a particularly good reader, especially when I was very young. And the one thing I liked was keeping a notebook, and that tends to be really true. So if anybody out there loves reading, you're already ahead of where I was. If you like writing or have ideas, I think Rue might say the same thing. Keeping a notebook that has story ideas in it, like if you've just read a great book and you've got an idea for something, and we were at dinner talking a little bit about fan fiction, but that's the way a lot of people start. My journals, I wrote endlessly in journals, and they are unbelievably boring to look back on because all I did was write down what we were having for dinner and what my homework was. And so don't do that, I would say, because you won't go back and find books to write, book
ideas. All at the same time, David Sedaris does that, and he says he gets
stuff.
It works
for him. It works for him. It's true. But anyway, I think that I was so shy about ever speaking it, but I think she gave me boldness in the way that Ramona and Beezus did, kind of encouraged each other for boldness.
Okay, so Rue, you talked about when you were in college, how you also did some studying of movie making.
Mm-hmm.
And I had not caught that about you, but it's interesting now hearing it, because something I was going to bring up was in your book, you change visual perspectives a lot. Mm. And sometimes in wildly different ways. And I was thinking, this feels a bit like somebody, laying out a movie and how they're going to show things. And you also have a lot of your panels, I figured more than a quarter of them, have no dialogue in them at all. And made me think of Stanley Kubrick's movies, who often go long stretches without anybody actually saying anything. But can you just talk a little bit about movies and how you go about doing this and those different perspectives that you use?
Well, the funny thing, as I mentioned earlier about movies and comics, is that they were both created and developed around the same time, which was the early 20th century. And that's why when we're drawing comics, we use movie terminology interchangeably. Like, if I was drawing this and I was describing the panel, I'd tell you know, whoever I was telling, maybe my editor, you know, I'm going to change the camera angle on this one, or, you know, we're going to go for a down shot to, you know, emphasize this and that. And those are all terms that, you know, you recognize from making films and TV. In terms of newsprints, I thought of it very cinematographically?
No.
What's the word?
Cinematically,
that's what it was. Got cinemagraphs in my head. Cinematically, in that I was more thinking about animation at the time. So people, you know, have likened it to Studio Ghibli's works. I will say that there is a heavy manga influence in my newsprint series as well, because I like it so much. And that's why there are many panels which are decompressing panels, which basically extend the moment of, you know, that's taking place by just not having any text or anything in it. It's just like moment for moment shots, as you would if you were just letting the camera roll.
You said there, your equivalent of letting the camera roll.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, when you read the book, you can see that you have some idea of how the pace is supposed to go, you know, mm-hmm. how things are moving, and, you know, what's slow and what's fast. And you made some comment earlier about that as well, that you can set the pace, or maybe I read that you said it. But it was another interview I read.
Oh.
But then you followed that up with saying, but the reader can then decide to control the pace mm-hmm. however they want. So you can create it, but mm-hmm. once you hand it over to somebody, it might turn out to be something different.
Yes, I like that aspect about comics, where basically I give you everything that you need visually to read the story, and then you meet me halfway and take your experiences into it and bring what you know your own reading pace and, you know, your own method of enjoying a book. Because, like, you know, you can always, like, go back. And it's like, well, that was a good scene, I'll redo that one again. Like, if you were rewinding. And I feel like with comics, I mean, it's like that with any medium, really. What am I saying? The best thing people tell me is that they like to reread my books. And because I do write my stories to have, you know, rereading value.
There's another line in the book where we hear Chester thinking as he looks at Gus, who's just staring out the window, and Chester says, maybe the window is where he watches TV shows that only play in his mind. And I want to hear a little bit more about that, but, you know, it made me think about something. There was a TV show in the 80s called Saint Elsewhere. Probably one of the first TV characters with autism, one of the major characters had a child. And the series ended.
I don't remember that.
Good. With this child looking at a snowball, and inside is the building of the hospital. And they don't say it explicitly, but they kind of leave you thinking that the entire 6-year show had been something playing in the kid's mind.
Wouldn't that have been incredible? Wow. I think that one of the puzzles when you're the parent of someone with autism is trying to figure out how that different brain works and what they're thinking about. And I think that's also true with animals, that we don't know what they're thinking about and what's so fascinating out that window. And I wanted them to be able to share that. It turns out there's a little something that they both have been watching happen over the course of this when they're getting to know each other. And and it's like that there was something there that neither of the parents saw, and hopefully until they look a little closer, that there's a little bit more meaning. I guess that's what I'm hoping. Should I give away what they're looking at?
Oh, that's your call.
But that we can share these meaningful understandings without necessarily always talking about it or having words.
Rue, mm-hmm. you talked about Blue and pretending to be a boy so she can be a part of a world that she's not supposed to as a girl. But underneath all that, there I mean, there's real strength in Blue. I mean, she's not just making her life happen the way she wants, but she's willing to stand up for what she believes is the truth and for doing what she thinks is the right thing. Can you just talk a little bit about her and those aspects?
Blue's very easy to write. She's very, if you read manga, she's kind of a, you know, standard protagonist who, you know, believes in justice and truth and is willing to fight for it. And usually, no, well, I'm not really sure what there is to say in terms to elaborate. One thing about Blue that a lot of people have asked me about is gender. And Blue is sort of one of those early pioneers in her time and in her city who sees something that she wants for herself, but you know, it's being barricaded by whatever societal rules that there are dictated at that time and place. And she's just one of those people who decided, you know, to cross over it in order to have what she wants. And I think, especially in today's society, we're doing that a lot more often. And I think it's just something that's very interesting and very good.
There will be more people who have questions than we will have time to take the questions. So please don't walk away feeling like you were ignored or something. I think there was somebody right over here.
Cammy McGovern, why did you make the character Penny in Chester and Gus? Like, why did you make her technically kidnap Chester in the end?
That's a great question. So one of the things that anybody who's interested in writing knows that you start with a situation, and a lot of times it's a situation that might be from your life, which is what I like to start with. So I had those different things like knowing an autistic kid and knowing a dog that had failed out of service dog. But you have to make, you have to have some bad guys in there, and you have to give the main characters some extra problems. And so I needed Gus to have a real problem, and that's what, down the line, what Ed is doing there. And then Chester had to have something that he had to figure out how to overcome. And I also wanted, Penny is kind of, hopefully she's a little bit weird to people, but I didn't want her to be completely unlikable, but she's just kind of crazy in how much she loves Chester and how interested she is, but that she gets the idea that there's one kind of job, if Chester's a super smart dog, that he should be this magical reading dog, and Chester in his heart knows there's a different thing for him out there. Hopefully that works, that there's something else he's meant to be doing, and it's not showing off and being on TV and reading.
Over here.
Miss Sue, how did you come up for the plot for Crow?
Well, I like birds a lot, so that's where Crow began. In earlier versions of the story, Crow was always going to be sort of a robot in the story. The most important thing was like sort of figuring out how his story worked with Blue's. And Crow is a robot pretending to be a human and just trying to fit in. Because that's, you know, one of the main themes is, you know, when we try to fit in, we, you know, be something that we're not.
Hey, there's one right next. Okay.
Cammy McGovern, so Chester talks to Gus in the book. With Ethan and Buddy, how did you realize that they had a significant communication that affected Ethan?
You guys, these are really good questions. They're really good. I would say that's one of those where I kind of had the real life thing, and then you start making things up. And I wanted, so you just are adding to make your story take off. So when you guys are writing your own stories, you're allowed to do that. You're adding pieces that are kind of magical elements. And I guess I wanted it to be that, because there's somebody else, for if you guys have read all the way through, that they're another person who understands what Chester's thinking. and her brain works a little differently too. And I guess I was thinking maybe brains that work differently can kind of meet somewhere and understand each other a little bit. And but I don't know if Ethan would have ever said that Buddy, like there were kids asking Ethan about Buddy, and he was saying, well, one thing he said was that he was really scared of Buddy at first and didn't like him because he had his tail was all over the place and his nose was unpredictable, and then he really grew to love him. But that's really true with kids with autism, that something's unpredictable, and also sensory things like, I just don't want you to touch me with your nose. So that little journey was true, but Ethan wouldn't say, oh, Buddy and I really could understand what each other was thinking.
Tammy McGovern, I want to ask you, why did the Gus find Chester when they were on that scary, spooky walk?
Okay, so that was one thing that was based on in real life, only what happened for us. Do you guys have a Six Flags around here that has one of those scary walks? And weirdly, Ethan loved going on those things. And only what happened was Ethan got lost on the walk. And the terrible part of the story, if any parents have read it, is that we were all there and we were with his brothers, and I said, oh, I'll go wait for Ethan at the end of the walk. And I got the idea for the book. I was in the middle of writing the book, and so I was sitting at the exit writing on like a little piece of paper, and Ethan walked by and got genuinely really lost in the park, and because I was so busy writing, I didn't see him leave. And we had to call the security. It was just an example of terrible parenting on my part and over fixating on. I would say that I was trying to figure out ways that they could help each other. And one thing that is hard to do when you have an animal at the center is what, and it's trying to be like, he's not a magic dog except for the understanding each other, but what could the dog and what could Gus really do to save each other? I was trying to think of different things they could do to connect and help each other and kind of connect and save each other and hopefully that one, that was.
Okay, rather than me trying to direct you guys with the mics, might just go to somebody you see. But is there somebody who has another question for Rue? Oh, here's one.
So I was wondering, you said earlier that you were originally wanting to go to law school. Why
yes.
was that? Or why were you wanting to do that?
My parents had expectations. And I thought I would make a good lawyer. While working on newsprints, I did take an LSAT prep class. And it made me realize that you had to think a certain way to be a lawyer. And people who were already who go to law school, they already have the mindset, or they're prepared to learn the mindset. And the mindset is actually very different from my personal current mindset, which allows me to write stories the way I like. And I felt like if I were to become a lawyer, I would have to like turn off the side of my brain that lets me make stories.
Amy McGovern, why in your book did you include Gus liking sparkly pens?
What was the last part of that? Gus and what?
Why did you include Gus liking sparkly pens?
The sparkly pen.
Oh, you know, that's a good question that somebody asked Ethan that. There's autistic kids are just funny and they love, and what Ethan loved to do when he was little, but he couldn't remember it, but he did it all the time. Autistic kids like things in their peripheral vision, which is another way that they're, so he used to do this with a sparkly pen all the time. And I remember doing it to try and see if it was like fun, but kids were asking him stuff like that. And now he can actually talk about it. It was really interesting. Cause what he does now is rock and do this. And somebody was saying, how come you're doing that with your fingers? And he said, I don't know, I'm just autistic and I like it. Mm-hmm. And that was that. But I think it was had to do with, he also liked things that beeped and noises. So he used to have a pen that made noises and I just made it a sparkly pen. And he also did, I can't remember in the book, is he wiggling it like that? No, he's doing peripheral vision stuff. But that's what Ethan used to do. Autistic kids are just funny, and the answer is, I just love it. It just is so funny, or I love doing it.
Cammie McGovern, why did you decide what Chester's weakness would be about loud noises?
That was the reason. So service dogs... it's such strict standards for them to get all the way through their training, and there's things that if they're distractible they'll fail out, and if they're there's a whole set of things, but one of them is if they're sound sensitive, and some dogs just are. Like, who's got a dog that runs under a bed during a thunderstorm? And that's just a dog whose ears are more sensitive, or else their systems. But that's also true with autistic kids, and that they process. It's one of the things that makes you see how autistic kids hear and experience everything differently, that they get so nervous and scared about fire drills, and it's something about that sound, and they get worried about it all day long if there's going to be a fire drill later in the day, and if they know about it, and they get ready with their headphones, and it's something that it's just very unsettling. It like jars their whole bones, and I wanted it to be like something they might have in common that way.
For Rue, a question I have is that you said that your work was often compared to Studio Ghibli. What would you think of your works being translated into a Netflix series or an animated production?
That would be awesome. people have been mentioning that more often to me lately. So if it happens, it happens.
This is a question for both of the authors.
Perfect.
What's it like being chosen for to be a Battle of the Books author? I never really thought about this until after I finished Battle of the Books, so I never got the chance to ask it.
Wait, this is great. Do you mind repeating the middle part? So you finished all the books and you didn't get a chance to ask the question about being a children's author. What was the second part of that question, though?
For Battle of the Books.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what
it was like, what's great about being a children's...
How does it feel that your book was picked to be a Battle of the Book?
Oh, okay.
Oh, well, yeah, I think it's awesome because Newsprints was a story that I hold near and dear to my heart. So to have like a lot of children, you know, kids and teenagers just reading it over and over to like learn all the trivia there is about it is super cool to me because I did put in a lot of trivia.
I would say actually I love the way you guys do Battle of the Books. I love that you have to learn everything about. There's a lot of places that I've been where they do it like a tournament where kids are voting, and they just do brackets like it's the basketball championship, and so you're competing against another book, and then one wins. And what ends up happening, that's okay too, because you can start with 40 books, and then when I was like traveling around to different schools, I was noticing it tended to be like the books that made it to the finalist were often similar, and it was because they were maybe shorter and a little bit easier to read, because everybody who was voting on them, for to be completely honest, I would have fallen into that trap too. But I love that you're just all reading the same books, and you get to all. So I'm thrilled to be part of it, and look, there's a whole room full of people who've thought about and have got great questions. So I really, really like the way you do it here.
All right, can we please give both of our authors and our interviewer a hand?